I'm set on you, and you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay long when I'm here with you. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. Mercies that are new, oh yeah. And my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay. It's a new horizon, yeah. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new, oh. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay alone when I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, and the truth, oh, and the light. Yeah, I believe you are the way, the truth, yeah, the light. I believe you are the way, the truth, oh, and the light. It's a new horizon tonight, yeah. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today, mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay long when I'm here with you. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today, mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to, because they can't stay long when I believe in you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the light. I believe you are.
goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so.
Everybody, we're so glad that you're here with us this morning, here physically or here on the web. We're going to jump back into worship in just a moment, but if you all would just pray with me for a second. Heavenly Father, we just thank you that we can gather in your house and in spirit to offer these sacrifices of praise to you, Lord. Lord, we just lift up high our worship, and we pray that it is pleasing to your ears this morning, and it's in your name. Oh, grip on me, for I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood.
Thank you.
is your victory in tow. Church, come stand in the light. The glory of God has defeated the night. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the gift that is Jesus. The one that has broken the chains, the curse of sin and death upon us. And the one that brings forth love, the one that transforms hearts. What a powerful thing, what a beautiful thing. We just bow before you in absolute awe and in gratitude that you would desire to bring us out of that curse and bring us to a place of unity and beauty and eternity with you. We just thank you for this, Father. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
When this whole corona thing started, many of you know, my lovely bride is an infection prevention nurse, so I was at ground zero. So I was told what I needed to do, and I got information straight from the horse's mouth. So I wasn't be very afraid. She said, this is what you're going to do. I said, yes, ma'am. But I also had thoughts, God says he'll get you through the storm. God says that he will provide, and we are of this world, or we are in this world, but not of this world. So I was never afraid through this whole thing. I mean, I used wisdom, and that's what we all should do. And if, you feel uncomfortable doing something, don't do it. If there's issues, deal with it. But I was angry because I'm a creature of habit, and my habits were disrupted, and there's no baseball. So those two things made me mad, but I was never afraid because I knew, one way or another, God would get us through it. I mean, the worst thing that could happen is I go to heaven, right? So it was like, okay, fine. But this covenant that we have with Jesus and what we're about to partake in is a covenant for that. As long as we do our part in the covenant, Jesus says he'll do his part. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come before your table. In Jesus' name we pray.
The King of my
my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my soul, and you are good, you're good. Oh, and you are good, you're good. The king of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my soul. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my soul. Sing that again. Let the king of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my soul. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my soul.
Never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, you are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We thank you, Father, that you love us so much and that you are so good to us. And it's in your name we pray.
Sarah. Good morning, everyone. It's great to see you here. If you're glad to be in the house of the Lord, can I hear a hearty amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right, just a couple of quick announcements. If you look on your bulletin, there's a contact card there at the bottom. One thing we have discovered is we don't have everybody's current phone number or current email address. So if you would fill that out, you can drop it in the offering plate, which is at the back by the wall, or you can drop it in the little tub out in the foyer. But we need to update all these contact numbers and emails so we can get in touch with you, so we can track you down, okay? Can you do that for me? If you can do that, say amen.
Amen.
That wasn't quite as loud as before now. Anyway, okay, also, for those who are watching from home, you can give online as well. Those who are here, the offering plates are in the back. And we are on a search. We are looking for a nursery worker. We need, if you like to rock little ones and play with babies, hey, we've got the position for you. It is a paid position. A few hours on Sunday mornings, a few hours on Wednesday night. Where else can you get paid to play with the little babies? Okay? So if you're interested, give us a call and let us know. But right now, let's start with a word of prayer this morning. Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us, Lord. We thank you that we live in a place where we can come together and worship you freely without fear of persecution. Father, we know that there are places across our country right now where our brothers and sisters are being restricted in their gatherings. And Lord, I pray for them. I pray that all the churches across our land would open up, that those who seek to come together and gather as a body of Christ can do so freely. Lord, I pray today that as I share your word, I pray that you would speak through me. I pray that your word would find its place in my heart and everyone else's heart, and it would take root there and change us forever. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We've been looking at the book of 1 Thessalonians. Let me just give you a little recap of the last couple of weeks. The first week we looked at an embracing church in chapter 1, and we looked at how the church took the gospel, took it to heart, embraced it, and began to reach out. The second week we looked at Paul's purpose as he planted and he nurtured and he led this church from afar. Today's title is A Caring Heart, and we're going to look a little bit more at Paul's heart and also the heart of some other believers there with this church. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, if you will, the first verse, so when we could stand it no longer. Think about that for a moment. When we could stand it no longer. Think back to when you were a little kid. It's December 22nd. What is it you're looking forward to? You're looking forward to Christmas Eve and Christmas morning. My son's birthday is in July, and he starts talking about his birthday by the 1st of January. And then once his birthday's over in July, he starts talking about Christmas, and he looks forward to it all year long. That's what Paul was looking forward to. When we could stand it no longer, he's much like a mother awaiting the delivery of a first child or a second child or a third for that matter. You remember what that anticipation was like? Well, anticipation. You remember that Heinz commercial? Anticipation, and the ketchup's just hanging and hanging and you can't get it out of the bottle. That's what Paul's anticipating. He's anticipating he wants to go and see these people. He's like a worker who is counting down the days to that next beach vacation. And he's longing. In fact, that was one of the points last week. He was longing to be with the church there. We thought it best to be left by ourselves in Athens. He was longing to go and visit the Thessalonians, but he knew he could not go there. Look, some of our brothers and sisters right now on the West Coast are longing together as a body as we are gathering right now. And the Supreme Court just ruled that their churches are non-essential. They sued the state, and the Supreme Court supported the state. Churches are non-essential. I've had a discussion this morning about some of the businesses that are open that the courts say are essential. I'm thankful we live in a place where we can gather in Georgia. I'm thankful we have a governor who says churches are essential. Yeah, we need to be wise. We need to be careful. We don't need to be scared. Just like Jim said, we don't need to be terrified. But I'm thankful we have a governor who sees the church as essential. I met him shortly after he took office and stood in his office, and I thanked him for some of the things he was doing. I and my son and a state rep were in the governor's office, and I thanked him. You know what he said to me? Keep us in your prayers, because there's a lot of things we're trying to do that we need your support. We need your prayers. I'm thankful we have a governor who's like that. Paul said, why did he think it was best to stay away? Think about this for a moment. If we go back to Acts, and I brought this out earlier, Paul was snuck out of town under dark. There was a riot. He was preaching the gospel, and the Jews there did not like it because some of the Jewish women and some of the Greeks and the prominent women were becoming Christians. And some of the ne'er-do-wells gathered together a bunch of guys and started a riot. Wow, we can relate to that right now, can't we? Anybody watch the news lately? We'll touch on that a little more toward the end of the sermon. But he knew that if he went back, his life would probably be in danger. And let's face it, Paul was not really worried about his life. He often invited persecution. He knew it was going to be tough to share the gospel. But he did not want to bring more persecution upon the church to which he's writing. He was snuck out of town under the cover of dark after those riots broke out. And what did he do? He went to the next town and began to preach the gospel there in that synagogue. So instead of going himself, the first point I want to make today is that Paul sent a helper. Verse 2, we sent Timothy, who is our brother and co-worker in God's service in spreading the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you in your faith. Now let's talk a little bit about Timothy. Timothy lived in the town of Lystra, which was not too far away. And Paul had been there on his first missionary journey. And he preached the gospel there. If you go to Acts 16, you can read about it. But Paul came to Derbe and Lystra, and as a disciple was there by the name of Timothy. But if we go back just a little further, let's go to 2 Timothy 1:5. For I am mindful of the sincere faith within you, which first dwelt in your grandmother, Lois. You see, Paul preached there, and Timothy's grandmother became a believer, and your mother, Eunice, and I'm sure it's in you as well. So Paul had preached there at some time past, and led these ladies to the Lord. And somewhere along the way, Timothy came to faith as well. And in Acts 16, we see that he meets Timothy, 16:1-3. He came to Derbe and Lystra, and a disciple was there named Timothy, the son of a Jewish woman who was a believer, but his father was a Greek. And he was well spoken of by the brethren who were in Lystra and Iconium. Paul wanted this man to go with him, and he took him and circumcised him because of the Jews who were in those parts, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. So Paul took Timothy under his wing at this point, and they began a relationship, much like a mentor and a protege. Almost a big brother, a father and an adopted son, that type of thing. You know, you might even say that Paul was the pastor and Timothy was an intern training to become the associate pastor who would eventually take over and lead some of these churches for Paul. At the very least, he was Paul's ambassador, and he would go. And we see that he sends Timothy to check on this church, and he sends a letter with him. Paul met Timothy in Corinth and gave him this letter and sent him on his way. What we see between Paul and Timothy is a relationship between someone who's already walked that path and somebody who wants to walk in his footsteps. Paul has trained Timothy. He has groomed him for this position and for this time. Proverbs 27:17 is one of my favorite verses in the Bible, and I think it applies to every believer. It says this, one person, as iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. I'll tell you that over the years, I've had a lot of people who have been in ministry longer than I have that I've spent time with, and they've told me some of the snares and pitfalls along the way. They've told me about their challenges. They've taught me how to handle certain situations. And if it hadn't been for those men and women spending time with me, I wouldn't be who I am. I remember when I was in college. I started college at 35, okay? That's not the time you normally start college. I walked into a classroom, and I'm surrounded by 18, 19, and 20-year-olds. And I had a particular class. It was on a Wednesday morning. It was probably one of the toughest classes I took, Biblical Greek. I do good to speak English. Forget about a biblical language. And so it conflicted with the ministry I was involved in a local school. And I went to the professor and I told him, I said, I have a hard time being here at 8 o'clock. Can I slip in late? He said, sure. He said, I have a better idea, though. Why don't you take and get a tape recorder and have somebody in the class record it for you? That way you catch the whole lecture. You can listen to it later. He says, you can't miss any more than you're supposed to, which was 10 out of 16 weeks. So that covered most of the Wednesdays. I asked a friend who was about 20 years old, can you help me with this? He said, yeah, not only will I tape it for you, I'll Xerox my notes and give them to you. And what he said next, really, I said, really? That's great. He says, look, we're all in this together. And that has stuck with me. This was a 20-year-old classmate who was encouraging me and helping me in a way that I'd never imagined. You see, because in college, there's a lot of competition in a lot of ways. You know, there's no limit on the number of students that may get that gold cord, the honors, but there's only one valedictorian. And by the way, that was not me. But he said, we're all in this together. Now, we did have classes where the competition was very real. We had one professor who graded on a true bell curve. That meant that there would be two A's in every class. Certain number of B's, certain number of C's, certain number of D's, and a certain number of F's. But if you were one of those two A's, you exempted the final. And let me tell you what, I was chasing that carrot because his finals were rough. Some of you may know him. His name was Bill Wade. His finals were rough. They were usually 120 questions. And I think I took four classes with him. And I managed to exempt three finals. And I was number three. I was the third person in line to exempt, and he said, nope, just the top two. So there's a competition there, but we're not supposed to compete as Christians. Timothy wasn't competing with Paul. Paul was grooming him and teaching him and saying, look, this is how you do it. Now you go do it. I think of one other classmate of mine. Her name's Miss Frieda, and I started school at 35. Miss Frieda was in her 70s. Just her very presence in a classroom was an encouragement to me. I'm thinking, she's in her 70s and she can do this? I quite often look to see how she was handling the pressure. You see, that's what Paul was doing, was teaching Timothy by example. Watch what I do. Yes, we're going to have hard times. Watch what I do and follow me. I'll tell you one more personal example. Went to Chicago. I'd never been to Chicago. Went on a mission trip. It was a youth mission trip. We rolled in after dark one night. We pulled into a lot that had a 12-foot fence with barbed wire on top. We walked across the street. We were staying in a homeless shelter. We had our own area, but it was a homeless shelter in a very rough neighborhood, Roseland. I don't know, Paul, do you know Roseland? It's a rough community. In fact, PBS did a special on their murder rate. It was right there at the top of per capita. In fact, when they took us in and showed us where we were staying, they shut the door. They said, listen to me. I'm going to shut this door and lock you in. You take that steel bar right over there and you put it across that door. You see that peephole right there? You don't open this door till you see this space through that peephole tomorrow morning. We had to go to the Walgreens. The guard at the Walgreens, when I say there was a guard, not like around here, he was armed. He wasn't just armed. He stood by the register with his hand on his pistol. It had a 12-foot fence around it. That kind of community. And one night we were to serve, most nights we were serving lunch to the homeless folks that came in during the day. Well, one evening we were scheduled to have dinner with them. And I'll be honest with you, even as a 30-something-year-old man, I was nervous. All the kids are lined up. They're all abuzz. I mean, these are middle and high schoolers. And they're abuzz about, what are we fixing to do? What are we fixing to do? What are we fixing to do? And I was nervous. I went in the back and prayed. I went and found a back stall in the bathroom by myself and prayed. Lord, this is not me. If this is going to work, you have to work through me and give me the strength to do this. And when the dining room doors opened, I went out there like I would for a church fellowship. I just went around introducing myself, talking to people. And it was tough because these folks were dirty. They were different. They had hard stories. Well, when we got back to Winston, Georgia, and we gave our Sunday night report, one of the girls said, you know, I was scared to death. She said, I didn't know how I was going to do it. And I thought to myself, I'm just going to watch what David does. Little did she know how scared I was. Paul is walking this path, and he's showing Timothy. He's bringing him along and teaching him. He had a concern for the church. He sent a helper to the church. And the next point is, Paul was concerned for the church. Look at verse 2 there again, the second part. To strengthen and encourage you in your faith. That's why he sent Timothy, so that no one would be unsettled by these trials. For you know quite well that we are destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, we kept telling you that we would be persecuted. And it turned out that way, as you well know. Paul sent him a helper to help them walk through this time, to strengthen and to encourage them. Don't forget that Paul has already been chased out of that town. He remembers that vividly. Paul was chased out of a lot of towns over the years, wasn't he? When he first started his ministry, he was lowered over the wall of a city. But he didn't back up at all, did he? He kept pressing on. He kept keeping on and sharing the gospel. Look at in verse 3 and verse 5. So we could no longer stand it. For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, Paul wanted to visit them. He longed for the church. If it hadn't been for being in fear of his own life and being in fear for the church, I imagine Paul would have stood his ground and continued preaching to the day they killed him. And he continued to do that throughout his life. But I imagine he did not stay there because he was fearful for the church itself. Now, I can relate in some ways, not that I've ever been in fear of my life by preaching the gospel. What I can relate to is not being able to connect with people personally face to face. My plan when I took the pastorate here, being lead pastor, my first part of business was I was going to start visiting through the church. And I was going to start with the senior adults. And I'm not visiting with them right now, not because I'm fearful for myself, but out of fear that I might potentially carry this virus to them, should I get it. But I have spoken to them. Much like Paul wrote his letter and sent it back to the church, I have been speaking with many of y'all on a regular basis, by text, by Facebook, by phone calls, and we are connecting in that manner. And I am so grateful to see you sitting here today. And for those of you at home, we long for the day when you'll be here again with us in person. It's ironic if you think about it. Paul's encouraging the church that's being persecuted. And how did we first meet Paul? Actually, his name was Saul when we first read of him. He was a persecutor of the church. In fact, in Acts, the first time we read of him, he's standing there watching guard over the cloaks of those who are stoning Stephen because Stephen had been preaching the gospel. Wow. God took one who was a persecutor of the church, of Jesus Christ, and he flipped them, and now he is probably the biggest proponent of the gospel message throughout all times. I mean, most of the New Testament are Paul's writings. He planted multiple churches, and he continued to communicate with them from a distance. And Paul knew if he went back, at the very least, the persecution would increase upon that church. In verse 5, he writes this, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter had tempted you, and that our labors might have been in vain. Who's this tempter that Paul writes about? He goes by a lot of names. Satan, the devil, Lucifer. There are other names. Look at 1 Peter. Well, you don't have to look at it. 1 Peter 5:8. Let me share it with you. Be alert and sober mind, of a sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. Let me say, here in America, we've gotten pretty content because we haven't really faced much persecution. We may say we've been persecuted, but we aren't facing persecution like much of the rest of the world. But we are in a very transitional time, and our world is changing greatly. We never thought we had to worry about security in a church meeting, did we? But nowadays we have to be concerned with that. But I've got friends who have literally faced persecution. I have a friend who was in Egypt, and it was during Ramadan. The streets were full of people celebrating as nightfall fell, and they could begin to eat again. And a crowd came to the door where he was staying, he and his family. And his host said, "Look, y'all go in the back room." It was a two-room apartment. And he could hear them saying, "Send out the Americans, send out the Americans." And the host said, "No, I'm not sending anybody out. Y'all go away." And this bickering went on for 10 or 15 minutes before the crowd finally left. It's real, folks. Persecution in other parts of the world. Being a Christian could cost you your life. We've kind of become complacent because we have freedom of religion. We need to be on guard. The tempter seeks to destroy, to kill, to lead us astray. Paul worried that these young believers, this new church, would be led astray or even fall away from the faith entirely. There are examples in American history where people have been led away. In the 1800s, there was a district in New York called the Burnt Over District. There have been many, many revivals. It's in western New York and central New York State. And this area was still frontier at the time. And these revivals broke out. And there were some folks that came out of those revivals that were very, very sound Christians. But several of our major cults that are still around today came out of these areas. There was one group there that came out of this. Now, this group's no longer around. But they came out and they predicted that Christ was going to return. I believe he's going to return. But they went further. They said he's going to return on October 22nd, 1844. That was a Tuesday. Wouldn't you like to sit in on their Wednesday evening Bible study? What was the topic of discussion that night? What happened? Did we miss it? Did we get left behind? Or, wait a minute, I don't see anybody missing. Would have been a tough, I wouldn't want to be on the teaching rotation that Wednesday night, for sure. Another group decided to live in communal communities, you know, in communes, more or less. And they began to teach that relations between men and women were sinful. They taught against marriage. At one time, they had 18 or more communities with hundreds and hundreds of followers. Well, because they don't marry, their only growth was by people who came into the faith or those they adopted. There's one community left today, and it's three or four women who are well into their 80s and 90s. Some strange teachings without good foundations. My point's this. In that newfound faith, in that enthusiasm of a new faith, this young church needed someone to guide them. And let me say this. Every new believer needs somebody who's more mature to come alongside, just like Paul did with Timothy, and say, "Hey, let me teach you. Let me tell you about what God says here in His Word." To keep them on that right path so that they are worshiping the one true living God and not following man's teachings or not being led astray by the tempter. I've experienced it where I've had young people that I've worked with for a long time and watched them drift away. I'm thinking of one person right now in particular that I've run back into recently. There was a time when this person would come to school early on a weekly basis and would sit in the floor with their Bible open, listening intently. And we would talk. They would come to me with questions, and we would talk about the Scriptures. And they professed faith. And they went to a local youth group and a local church. Well, I've recently reconnected, and I've seen some things on Facebook that are antagonistic, not toward me personally, but toward Christianity as a whole. And from what I can discern, this individual has a significant other that is hostile to Christianity. And this person has slipped away. And it's heartbreaking to see. It's heartbreaking to see. Scripture teaches about not being unequally yoked. And it's not just about, though, marriage or dating. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul writes, do not be misled. Bad company corrupts good morals. A friend of mine who was a youth minister and then a missionary and then an associate pastor in Texas now used to put it this way. You tend to become like those you spend time with. That's a great summary of what Paul wrote. You tend to become like those you spend time with. So we need to look around and check and see who we're spending time with. We need to find somebody and go, hey, I want to be more like that person or that person. We need to find godly people to model ourselves after. Paul writes over and over in this letter about being imitators of Christ, imitators of Him, imitators of the churches that are in Christ. This tempter that Paul writes about, he uses many tools. Let me just mention a few of those. Self-doubt, negative self-talk, guilt, shame, doubt. How about some of the things America says are great? Business opportunities, money, possessions. I'm not one that says we need to sell it all and live in a shack. I don't have a problem with material things as long as we keep them in their proper perspective. It should never come between us and our relationship with Jesus Christ. Even job. Your career can be something the tempter uses. It may be he may use that to put you in the company of somebody that's going to pull you aside, pull you off course. I don't know, but you fill in that blank. What is it that the tempter uses in your life that distracts you from focusing on that relationship with Jesus Christ? 1 Peter 5:9, resist him, standing firm in the faith. Paul knows that the persecution has broken out, and he fears for the church there. He was concerned for the church. He sent a helper. And then when Timothy returns, Paul rejoiced in the good news. He rejoiced because he had a caring heart. He cared about this group of believers that he helped to lead to Christ. He helped to organize the church, and he continued to connect with them even when he couldn't physically be there. Now, here's my mind running. How did Timothy give this report? Did he just come running back up to Paul and say, hey, Paul, this is what happened. This is what I saw. Or did he bring a letter from the Thessalonians? Probably both, I would imagine. I can't imagine that if a friend sent me a letter from afar by a personal messenger, I can't imagine not sending a letter back. I mean, I don't know about you, but when the postman comes by my house, I doubt he returns back to the post office empty-handed, right? He's delivering and picking up mail and carrying it back and forth. We're not talking about Amazon. We're talking about the USPS, okay? I get a letter. Another letter goes back. It may be a few days or a few weeks, but a letter generally goes back. And he heard about what was going on. He was excited. He rejoiced in it. But regardless of how they communicated, if it went back and forth, this is in verse 6, news about your faith and love. Now, let me say, Paul doesn't mention the word hope here, but he does throughout this letter in some other places. And it makes my mind go right to 1 Corinthians 13, faith, hope, and love. A triplet of things that we ought to be showing for one another and for the world in general. We have faith in Christ, and we share that with others. We have hope in tomorrow and in eternity because of our faith. And as a result of that, we overflow with the love of Christ for others in all circumstances. And I know that can be tough sometimes, but that's what we're called to. In verse 6, he tells us that he always had pleasant memories of the church, and long to see us just as we long to see you. The church is longing to see Paul just as Paul longs to see them. It's a mutually encouraging relationship of one who met Christ, who led folks to Christ, and who wants to see them grow in Christ. Verse 7, therefore, brothers and sisters, in all our distress and persecution. We were encouraged about you because of your faith. I already spoke of Miss Frieda sitting in class with me in her 70s. I'm thinking, if she can do this, I can do it. I remember her looking at me one time, and I said, how do you stay so upbeat? She said, baby, I just keep on keeping on. I just keep on keeping on. Some days that's what we do. We just put one foot in front of the other. We keep following Christ, knowing he holds it all in his hands, and somehow it's going to work out in the end. We may not know all the answers, but we put our faith, our hope, and our trust in him and him alone. And we love one another, and we encourage one another, and we spur one another on to good deeds and works, even in the face of COVID-19, even in the times when we can't physically meet together. Verse 8, for now we really live, since you are standing firm in the Lord. There again, he's encouraged by them standing firm. Look, you never know who's watching. That young girl that gave the report said, I'm scared to death to eat with the homeless folks. I just watched what David did. She didn't know I'd been in a bathroom stall shortly before that, going, Lord, I can't do this. This has got to be you. Paul's encouraged by watching these young believers. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy we have in the presence of our God because of you? He was encouraged by their faithfulness. Paul and Silas found joy knowing they were standing firm. How do we stand firm in our faith? What if I told you there was one verse in the Bible here that if you do everything it says, I believe it would change your life completely. Or it would help you to grow closer to Christ. You'd want to know what that one verse is, wouldn't you? Acts 2:42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Now, it was kind of a trick statement because that very first part of it, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings. While that one verse is central, it leads you back to every word in this book, from Genesis all the way through maps. Oh, not maps, Revelation, because not all your Bibles have maps in the back. But if you devote yourself to the apostles' teachings, this is what they were teaching, God's Word. Paul's already commended the Thessalonians earlier in this letter that they took the Word, not as man's Word, but as it is, as God's Word. If we devote ourselves to the Word, we're going to be changed. They devoted themselves to the fellowship. That's why you're here today. And those folks who are at home, again, we long for the day you feel comfortable and safe being here. But until that time, hey, if you can't fill out one of these cards, okay, but call up and leave your stuff on the answer machine. I'll call you back, I promise. We want to stay connected with you. Devote ourselves to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread. What is that? Well, we broke bread today, the Lord's Supper. And it's more than that, too. It's fellowship meals. And I've had the blessing of breaking bread with some of y'all. Hamburgers, Philly cheesesteaks. Got one scheduled this week. It's going to be ribs and a pork loin on the smoker. I'm looking forward to it. See you then, Jimmy. Breaking of bread. Think about this for a minute. For a Jewish man, you didn't break bread with just anybody. Sitting down at a table to share a meal meant a lot more than just eating. So when it says the breaking of bread, it carries so much more weight with it than just having a meal. It's not like sitting down in a cafeteria or a food court with just everybody. It implies some intimacy, that we're coming together as brothers and sisters in Christ. And they devote themselves to the breaking of bread and to prayer. We should start with prayer. How often do we turn to prayer as our last resort? Very easy. I don't know about you, but as I've gotten older, I'm 56. This summer I turned 56. And, you know, I have those times in the middle of the night, for whatever reason, just out of a deep sleep, I wake up. And I've started using that as a prompt to pray for somebody I know. Many of y'all come to mind when I wake up at 3 a.m. for some reason and can't roll over and go right back to sleep. I also use when I feel tempted by Satan or I'm struggling with an issue. For years, I have used that as a prompt to pray. And let me tell you what I've discovered there. The last thing the devil wants to do is to prompt me to go to the throne of grace. I don't pray for myself. I pray for somebody else. And that's the last thing Satan wants me to do is to go to the throne of grace with a request on somebody else's behalf. And I found by doing that quite often, whatever I was struggling with seems to just fall aside. The temptation seems to disappear. Let's go down to verse 10. Paul prayed for the church. Night and day we pray earnestly that we may see you again and supply what is lacking in your faith. Now, he doesn't tell us what was lacking, but I'm sure he's wanting to help them set down deeper and deeper roots in their knowledge and their love and their service of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you, the point of salvation is when you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and at that point you're a new creation, but a new creation has to grow and develop into what it can be. And that's what Paul's talking about. He wants to help them mature. Verse 11, now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus clear the way for us to come to you. He is praying that he can get back there to see them. And may the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else just as ours does for you. May he strengthen your heart so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones. Once again, we see a deep, caring heart that Paul has for these believers, for this church. He desires to be there. He prays that their faith will mature. Let me tell you, physically we mature over time and our bodies are going to change whether we like it or not. I'm on the backside of that. I'm not liking so much of what I'm seeing, but it happens. We can't stop it, can we? Can I tell you, though, I've seen Christians, I'm not saying they aren't true believers, but I've seen them become a believer and then never mature. My term for it is pew potatoes. They come to Christ and they believe him, they accept him. I'm not doubting their salvation, but then they take up a spot in the church and they're just a pew potato and they just sit there. They don't grow, they don't reproduce, they don't serve, they just come, they listen, they partake. And again, I'm not saying they aren't part of the family of God, I'm just saying they're not what God intends for them to be. Paul desires for them to grow in their faith, in their love. He's praying that their love might abound. It means to exist in a large quantity, to increase to overflowing. And I'm going to say this. I know at times I struggle in that area. You know, I have actually said, you know what, Jesus loves you, but I'm really not so sure about you at the moment. It's kind of a little joke around my house. I'll say that from time to time. But I know at times I struggle with showing the love of Christ, particularly in those tough times when we're bumping heads with somebody or situations out of my control and I'm at the mercy of someone else that's not showing me very much grace. And I have to remind myself, I'm an ambassador. I need to take the high road. I need to show that love, even to those challenging folks. He's praying their love might abound. And then he's praying that they might be blameless and holy in the eyes of God. Wow, that's a tall order, isn't it? And truthfully, we know we cannot do that or achieve that on our own. We can only do it through the person of Christ Jesus. Now, we're not facing persecution like the church did in this town or any other town where Paul traveled. But we are in a time of transition. We're in the time of a time of transition as a church. I mean, we're, our long-term pastor retired, and you know, now we've got a new guy. That's me. And on top of that, it happened at a time where, hey, you're the pastor. We're not going to have church. We don't know when we're physically going to meet here again. And I'm grateful that our retiring pastor got us up live streaming and online giving because it allowed me to step in and not have as much to worry about. I've already told you what my plan was to start visiting people physically and meeting them in their homes. That went out the window real fast. But we're not just in times of transitions as a church. Our country's in times of transition with this virus. And I mentioned riots a minute ago. How many of y'all sat at home and watched the riots in Atlanta and other cities around the nation just a few nights ago? It's heartbreaking. I happened to have been working, just finishing up polishing this sermon, going over my notes, when I heard something on the television, and my 10-year-old was watching, and I went in to see what was going on. And I have to explain to him why. I have to try to explain the unexplainable to him. Let me make it clear. Rioting, looting, destruction is never an acceptable form of protest. It's just not. It takes away from the issue at hand. And with that said, let me also say that brutality of the police department or any other civil authority is not acceptable. Look, every person that walks the face of this earth is made in the image of the one true living God. It doesn't matter where you're from, what your name is. It doesn't matter what your religion is or the color of your skin. You are made in the image of the one true living God. And he calls us all unto himself. So let's pray for our country. Now back to us as a church. I would ask you to pray for us, for the elder board, as we begin to plan how we come out of this time of not meeting. You know, I've heard it said that it takes 3 weeks to establish a habit. Most of us were out of this building for about 7 or 8 weeks. Some will be out closer to 3 months or more before they can return to these doors, to these premises. And right now, while we're open for worship, we're not offering the full slate of Sunday school and children's programs. And right now, we don't know when we're going to begin to do that. It's coming. We're planning for it, but we don't know when we're going to open up fully. And we want to make sure we do it mindfully, prayerfully, so that we're all safe. And we want to take care of it. We're making those plans. But again, it's a time of transition. In fact, right now, take a minute and look around the worship center. And everybody, just look around for real and take note of somebody that's not here in this room today. And here's your challenge. This week, I want you to pick up the phone and call them. Check on them. Make sure they know you're not trying to pressure them to be here next Sunday, but check on them. Can you imagine if you're a senior adult who lives alone? It's almost like you've been placed in solitary confinement. Reach out. And don't do it just with the folks here. Think about other people in your life and call them. Connect with them however you communicate with them. Text, Facebook, whatever their preferred. Pull up in their driveway, blow the horn, and they can stand on the porch and you can roll the window down. I've had a number of those visits. And there's nothing wrong with that. Do whatever they're comfortable with. You know, take lunch over there, and they can sit in that rocker, and you can sit in that rocker on the porch. But make sure they know that we have not forgotten about them. And folks, if you're at home right now, we love you, and we want you here, and we're here for you till you feel comfortable being here. Now, think about this for a moment. Your presence here today is an encouragement to everybody in this room. If you're in this room, that's an encouragement to me. In my 20 years of working in the public schools, Wednesday mornings were one of my favorite mornings because I knew the school I was going to, I was going to show up and there's going to be 30, 40, 50, 100. There have been schools where I've shown up and there have been 300 students who came in early to hear the gospel. But you know what? There were days where I show up and there'd be 12 at a school. But those 12 were an encouragement to me. Those mornings were the days that made me excited. Those were the days that brought joy to me. Showing up and seeing their smiling faces, even if they're still wiping sleet out of it, shoving a biscuit in their mouth. By the way, no biscuits in the worship center, okay? But looking and seeing y'all here is an encouragement to me. And whether you realize it or not, it's an encouragement to everybody else. Amen? So, if you're here today, and I know life has ways of pulling us away, sometimes you can't help it with work, but if you're here today and you can make it an important thing to be here, and there are those mornings you're going to get up, hey, look, there's mornings I get up, and I'm like, oh, I really just want to go back to bed. My wife says, nope, you can't. You're the preacher. You got to go. But getting here and seeing your faces, coming together and singing God's praises is an encouragement to one another. Amen. We love to meet face to face. I got to thinking about this and I think I'm going to put this up on my computer there at the house where I'll see it. Using Paul's words here as a pattern for prayer. Pray that each one of you is growing in your faith. Pray that we're all maturing in our faith. I hope you'll pray the same for me as well. I have a friend who's a pastor, and he told me, he said, there was a period of a couple of years. Now, when I say he's a pastor, he pastored church for about 35 years. He said, there was a couple of years in there where I only went into the Word to find a message to share on Sunday morning. He said it was some of the driest times in my life. So I would ask you to pray that I'm maturing and growing in my faith and I'm doing the things I'm encouraging and urging you to do. That I maintain a time with the Lord, listening, praying, and reading His Word, not to find a message to bring to the church, but digging into the Word, seeing what God has to say to me. And I pray that our love for one another and for a lost and dying world continues to grow, to abound, to overflow, so that others will find the hope that we have found. There's a hymn, it's an older song that I love, and Sarah, I probably should have got with you. You probably could have played this today, and maybe we'll play it in the future. They will know we are Christians by our love. I love that song. They will know we are Christians by our love, by our love. They will know we are Christians by our love. That's what we're called to share, the love of Jesus Christ. We're called to have a caring heart, just like Paul did for this church and for all those he reached out to. And we're called to that, and I hope and pray that each one of us will be found blameless and holy on that day when the Lord returns, or that day we meet Him individually when our days are done. Because what we really long for is to hear those words. Well done, good and faithful servant. Come in and receive your just rewards. Let's pray. Lord, we live in some crazy, crazy times. We even joke sometimes right now, Lord, about what's going to happen next. But we rejoice in the fact that we know You hold all things in Your hand. Lord, in the midst of a pandemic, we know that we can put our hope and our trust in You. That we need not be terrified. That we need not be scared. We simply need to be smart about what we do. And we know that should this be our last day here on the face of this earth, we know that eternity with You is the reward. And for that, we give thanks, Lord. Help us to carry ourselves in such a way that others will notice. Help us to stay strong and firm in our faith, that we would not backslide or slip away. May we pursue you with all that we are and all that we have. And Lord, may it be the desire of our hearts to glorify you with and in all these things so that others would know your Son Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. It's in his name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.
To the masses.
to the masses that He is God. Father, we ask for the strength and the courage. We ask for Your Holy Spirit to fill us to the brim, so that when we go out, we will overflow with Your love and Your power and Your strength and Your mercy, and that those who would come to us would witness us, they would witness Christ fully and completely and wholly, Lord. Only You can do this. Only You can transform hearts. Only You, O Most High King, can bring about this incredible change. We ourselves cannot. You can. They will know us by our love. They will know us by Your love. We pray that You would be with us, and it's in Your name we pray. Amen. Thank you, everybody, so much for coming. You are all dismissed.